Hey guys, it's Dani. Today we will talk about slipper orchids once again, but we will focus on the Paphiopedilum orchids. This is not a care guide per se, it's a more practical guide. I find there are a lot of things that articles don't tell you, and while it's absolutely important that you know the light quantity, temperature, and other little quirks that these orchids have, it's equally as important to know the hands-on experience with these orchids. And I do have a few things that I would like to share with you, so that's why I'm titling this video a practical guide rather than a theoretical care guide. We will go through the care as well, but being that I don't have as many years of experience with these guys as I do with the cattleyas or other things, I'm not gonna go into the full care guide. I will, however, link you down below to the AOS care guidelines. We're gonna touch base a little bit on them as well, but not very much, because I think there are many important things you should read about them there. However, though, let us talk about the practical aspect of things, how it is to actually own these orchids, live with them, their little quirks that articles don't mention, and I hope these will be useful just as much as the theoretical guidelines are. So, first of all, in the vast majority of cases, Paphiopedilums are not epiphytic orchids. They can be litophytes, but they're not all that airy as other litophytes. And I know this sounds a little strange, but bear with me. In their natural habitat, even though they might grow on rocks, these rocks can be full of mosses. Some Paphiopedilums are straight terrestrial, while others are somewhere in between depending on their geographical location. The same species can be found as a litophyte in particular territories and as a terrestrial in other territories. Bottom line is, they're not epiphytic creatures. And in my experience, they absolutely hate air. Now take that with a grain of salt. These guys are never black and white, they're a varied array of shades of gray. No pun intended, I don't like that movie. So being that they're not epiphytic, the first thing you will notice is that they have no aerial roots. And this is because their roots do not grow in the air. You will also notice that the new roots, which you can clearly see above the medium, they will not really grow and reach the medium if they're not very close to it or the humidity is not all that high. New roots need to be in contact with the medium or very close to it, somewhere where the humidity is very high, otherwise they will not grow. So the first thing you will need to do is make sure that your Paphiopedilum is not potted way too high. It shouldn't be potted way too deep either. You will pretty much need to find that balance. And it can be tricky. At least for me, it was pretty tricky until I figured it out. I had to re-repot my first Paphiopedilum because first, I potted it directly in chunky bark. And that wasn't okay. It was too airy. My Paphiopedilum did not want to grow roots for the life of me. Then I figured it out a little bit and I potted him a little bit lower in the medium. And I do believe I also made a mixture between sphagnum moss and bark. That's what I had available at the time. And poof, problem solved. But if you don't know this from the beginning, you might actually wake up one day with your Paph simply dehydrated and rootless because you chose a way too airy medium and you potted him way too high and your roots simply didn't grow. Environment will have something to say with this as well. Maybe in cooler environments, things are not so drastic, but in a temperate environment and in a warm environment, I would not go with chunky bark and potting these guys above the medium. As a little guide, I would make sure that the first set of leaves is not buried in the soil, but the soil or medium, however you want to call it, should be directly under the first set of leaves. Don't let a lot of space between the leaves and the medium because that's typically where the new roots come from. Now, the medium you're gonna use will have to be your choice. There are many different setups or media used with slipper orchids, and they have to do with environment and with your availability to water, repot, and so on and so forth. Typically, people grow them in a mix of coco peat or even peat and bark or perlite or something that will aerate the medium a little bit. Some people go with bark chips, but small grade, also mixed in with other things to maintain things rather airy. Other people with sphagnum moss, many people in semi semi-hydroponics as well. All of these things can work in the right environment and with the right person. As for me, I think I prefer the Repot Me mix, which is a blend of small grade bark combined with other fun stuff that maintain it a little airy. This mix that I tried out, it worked really great. Problem is, it's already decomposed. I need to get rid of it, I need to change it. But it did work pretty great for the 2 or 3 months that I used it. Another thing about these orchids, which might surprise you, is the fact that they are actually sympodials, not monopodials. Yes, they can look a little bit like phalaenopsis, but they actually have a rhizome. And these little growths, they're not keikis, they're actually the new growths. Just like sympodials, new growths create the new root system and bloom. The older growths will not bloom again because they have what we call a terminal spike, meaning a spike that arises directly from the crown, so the new blooms will always come from the new growth. Now, what happens to the old growth, you might wonder? Will it stay around and conserve energy and nutrients? Not really. Actually, in time, the old growth will just wither off and die. And that can come as a shock because it will start to yellow. You will think, oh my goodness, my plant is dying. I need to give it more water. I need to give it more nutrients. You will have to get some experience, but at some point you will see the older growth just wither away and you'll be completely fine with it. That is something Paphiopedilums do. However, every growth can create multiple new fans, so you can actually reach to the stage of actually having a specimen, a bushy, bushy plant, simply due to the sheer number of growths that these orchids can produce. So in the end, even if the older growths will wither off, you will have more and more new growth, which will create more and more new growth. So in the end, you can actually end up with a specimen-sized Paphiopedilum. So if you are concerned with that, don't be, you can get to a bushy plant even with these guys as well. If you've never repotted a Paphiopedilum orchid, you've never read about it or seen a video about it, the roots will come as a shock as well, because they are brown, they do not photosynthesize, and to top it all off, they're also a little fuzzy. Well, those little hairs, they help the orchid reach water and absorb it better. And one thing to be careful with is handling the roots. Some of them can be quite brittle. They're really not as flexible as other epiphytic orchids are. But nonetheless, they're very interesting and quite cute, I find. As I was saying, Paphiopedilum orchids produce a terminal flower spike, which concludes the life cycle of a growth. Now, their flower spikes, just like other orchids, tend to grow towards the light source. So if you're keeping your Paphiopedilum orchid next to the window, you will start to see the flower spike starting to lean towards the window as well. One thing you can do is to start staking it as you see it develop, as you see it grow. I think I do actually have a video on this. I'll link it down below. I'll search in my archive. So as the flower spike grows, you can stake it, pin it to a stake and maintain it straight. If this is the look you're going for, you could also try to rotate the orchid so that the flower spike remains straight. I find that technique a little hit or miss. I could never get something super straight with doing that. Furthermore, it kind of ended up twisted and contorted. I prefer not to do it, but if you feel you're gonna have better luck, you can definitely try it. Or my preferred technique right now is just offering light from above. My Paphiopedilums naturally grow with the light source above them on my shelf, but you don't need an LED panel or anything. These are low light plants. So when you see your Paphiopedilum starting to produce a spike, you can actually put it under a lamp. And here you go, this is pretty much the setup. That's an IKEA lamp that I actually use with my files right now. And the subject is not the path we had earlier because we had a little accident. I guess we shall retire him from this video, and also no lunch for me today. And speaking of flower spikes, how do we know our Paphiopedilum is producing a spike? Well, depends on the path. If you have one with a tall stem, when it starts to produce a spike or a bud, you can actually feel a bump right here on the stem. It starts somewhere at the medium, and as it grows, it continues to move upwards. And I think if we look on a profile, you can see the little bump in this Paphiopedilum. Here's another example. I think this is even more visible. Well, it started to poke through the top as well, but I hope you can see it. With some Paphiopedilums that don't have a lot of space in between the leaves, you obviously cannot feel anything, but you will see right in the crown, that at some point a leaf which is darker in color and quite a lot more fuzzy will appear. That's a little sheath, and inside it you'll have the bud. When Paphiopedilums grow their flower spikes, you'll first notice the bud, and then the flower spike will grow as the bud matures. It's quite a really interesting process to observe. Being that Paphiopedilums prefer to stay rather moist, and depending of course on the medium you're growing them in, you might start to have some issues with fungus gnats in your environment or in your grow space. My preferred way to deal with them is the use of carnivorous plants that feed on very tiny insects. Things like sundews and pinguiculas, which I had a lot of years ago, do a great job at maintaining populations low. You will probably never get 100% rid of them, but you can get such a low population that it will definitely make a difference. Not to mention, they just look so incredibly pretty, and rather than putting up yellow papers or other sticky tapes, I do prefer to keep some carnivorous plants next to my Paphiopedilums or the orchids, which stay a little bit more moist or are potted in a more soily, let's say, medium. I've never had flowers from my sundews, but from the pinguiculas I did, and they're really pretty. They're purple and just really nice, so I do consider these carnivorous plants to be perfect and quite ideal companion plants for Paphiopedilums. And as a last note, Paphs can be absolutely gorgeous even if they're not in bloom, particularly the mottled leaved ones, which I am just discovering this year. They have been doing really great for me in the past year, so I am expanding the collection, and as I will learn them, I'll definitely make a care tutorial based on experience rather than articles, as soon as I'm comfortable with it. Today though, I just wanted to make this more practical guide, just because I did not see all that many sources talking about it. So I hope you've enjoyed this, I hope this was useful. As for me, I am going to take care of my little fallen path. Thank goodness I didn't bring the flower spike. I would have been devastated because I've been waiting on this guy for a year. However, since we're here, let's take a look at the root system. And it's not bad. The medium is really stinky, but there we have it. I'm gonna go repot him, I'm gonna film the root tips, and I will include them in this video, and then hopefully I'm gonna have some lunch. So thank you guys for watching. You know the drill, like or dislike this video below, subscribe to my channel for regular orchid videos, tutorials, Q&As, and other fun orchid subjects. And if you like YouTube to notify you whenever I upload a new video, just turn on notifications for my channel. Recently, I started to have activity on Instagram as well. I will link you my Instagram down below. I do like to post photos, but I feel like there aren't many people just watching the community page on YouTube, and I got so much more response on Instagram, even though I didn't post there in years. So yeah, I'm gonna start to post pictures there as well. If you're into that, check my profile down below. And for any other details regarding my setup, just visit the description. I always list everything there. So with that said, I'll see you guys next time. Bye!